It's a pleasure to be with you to talk on a Saturday morning about everybody's favorite topic. And I hope that what we have to offer you today will be worthy of your time and effort and a little of that money. So I do appreciate it. Obviously, people who come to my events, they have a vested interest. They want understanding to serve others more effectively, or they have concerns for someone that they love or know, or they themselves have struggles. Not that we need to look at each other and get nervous, but all of us in the room are sexual creatures, and all of us in the room got a fallen nature in a fallen world with a predator that makes us vulnerable. And add to it, you know, we have those hormonal urges coursing through our veins with the onset of adolescence, and then of course we struggle because we have a heart that desires to be loved. And so we shouldn't be surprised that people do struggle in sexual ways. We're going to look more specifically today, unlike a lot of my material, which addresses many kinds of sexual themes, we're going to be a bit more focused today with the issue of sexual abuse. And before we launch into the teaching content, I do want to make mention that I have a selection of materials available for you, and we will be giving you a handout later, which will describe these items in detail, and we've got some of them available for sale at a table out in the foyer. And, you know, I've been in full-time ministry this July for 25 years, and I've been working cross-culturally for 2 decades. And my work takes me anywhere from 3 to 6 continents per year, which has been a great education for me to get to observe, regardless of continent, culture, or denominational culture, what the Lord is doing with regard to sexual redemption themes. And certainly in Western culture, church denominations are indeed being challenged with, in many different ways, with these concerns. And so we've learned over the years that not talking doesn't make us holier or healthier. We're going to be talking about these concerns, and I'm glad that you want to be here today when you could be doing other stuff. But in my years of pastoral care, and I've lived abroad for about half of my Christian ministry, and spent 11 years outside the United States, my homeland, 7 years in Singapore, where I was one of 25 pastors with a very dynamic Anglican church. I always like to comment, there is hope for the Anglican church, although it's probably out of North America. And I enjoyed that season of 7 years in Singapore, where I pioneered the very first sexual redemption ministry in all of Asia's 3 billion people. I'm glad I didn't know at the time, but I wondered why the event that we were unpacking there was so scrutinized, and now I understand why, because there had never been a model like that before in Asian culture. So that ministry has birthed 4 other ministries in other parts of Asia as well, and it's kind of cool to see that continue to unfold. And then I came here to New Zealand, and lived here for 4 glorious years on the Kapiti Coast, and am very grateful that though I've been back in North America 3.5 years, I have the chance to come back down under about 3 to 4 times per year. So it's nice to continue that affiliation and connection and make investments here. And so there you are. I'm really happy to be back here personally, not just professionally. So these materials that we've got produced for you, I'm a missionary with Calvary Chapel in Fort Lauderdale, Florida, a little church of about 25,000 people, and I call it Calvary Chapel International Airport. And but these materials are professionally produced, and what we offer is Lessons Learned, Volume 1 and Volume 2. Both of those are available on audio CD here, coming soon, in fact, in about a week, on DVD. You can order these items online at either my website, cyrogers.com, or at regenbooks.org. And these items, each package offers you 6 hours in red and 6 hours in blue. And this works together as seminar content to provide understanding to help others or manage your own sexuality. And then I have my story, One of the Boys, available also on VHS, on audio CD, and coming out in about a week on DVD. And One of the Boys is more than just my story of sexual brokenness. It's a story about the wonderful character of God in the middle of all my mess and what he did to bring redemption to me and how he took me further. We also have a sub-teaching on there, why Christians will have sexual struggles, and that if you do, you're not bad, God's not mad, you're normal and human, but what are you going to do about it is the question. And then I have my booklet, Questions I'm Asked Most About Homosexuality, the top 10 questions dealing with psychological, biological, and theological concerns that are confronting church culture on this often misunderstood issue. Then I have Sigh in the Hot Seat, Questions My Audiences Ask Me Most. And of course, the associate pastor of Calvary Chapel, here we are in this live event, and the very first question he wants to ask is, well, what about oral sex? So not being shy, I, we jump right on in and deal with questions that church culture often does not adequately address. But that doesn't mean people don't have questions. It's just they often have to go elsewhere to get their information. So rather than Sex and the City doing the education or Cosmo magazine advice columns, we think God also has a redemptive opinion about all of this stuff, and we like to share at least my very opinionated opinion. And you can get that and 25 other questions on Cy in the Hot Seat, and then my current dance club album. I know, good pastor by day, aging disco singer by night. It's very embarrassing. But there you go. And let me mention, you know, I moved to New Zealand, actually, to join a band and launched a four-continent world tour from New Zealand, and I just decided to stay. And music doesn't get as much attention because most people know me for the work that I do with sexual issues. But it's nice to say that this current album on the Parachute label, it's about 2 years old, and we've had a song come in at number 2 and a song come in at number 17 on the Christian Contemporary MP3 charts in the U.S., and we had a DJ hit in the U.K. off the album, and it features some wonderful Kiwi talent, which I'm glad to promote. So there you go. The reason we do this is one-third of my album sales go to unbelievers. And if you know anything about the sexual underworld, you know that it is an underworld that loves dance club music. And so we're well-produced, we can stand our own with other secular sounds, but we offer this as one more way to bring the light of God, like Matthew's party, to people who won't darken the door of the church or won't take your tract or brochure, but they do like music. Makes the people come together, Madonna knows. So that's why we do it, and it's a great opportunity to take this message further. So we offer it as a strategy, so that if you know someone who might be open to this music, there we have it for you, and we're getting ready to begin working on our next retrospective. I've been a recording artist for a decade now, and this is my 7th project that I've worked on. You can come online and find more about the music that we offer. And there you go. See what you didn't know. There you go. So these items, I hope, will continue to serve and encourage you. Again, they are available and at discounted prices, I must say, out there in the foyer. So thanks for shopping Cymart. Now, if you're not familiar with my story, again, who here hasn't hurt me? Okay. And who's from Los Angeles? Where in L.A.? Okay. Cool. Love L.A. I'm out there all the time and was just out there teaching at Azusa Pacific. In fact, earlier I became an adjunct professor at a Christian liberal arts college in New York City. In fact, my classroom is in the Empire State Building, which is both fabulously glamorous and extremely paranoid all at once. And I have a 45-hour, 3-credit course available now called Sexuality and Contemporary Culture so that we can understand our inner world better in Christ and that we can manage it better and that we can also understand others that we want to serve and disciple, but also so that we can represent God with greater confidence in culture when often our views do get challenged. So that's what the course is about. And it's nice to be able to teach that in other places, including a lot of wonderful schools that are in the greater Los Angeles area, like Biola, Azusa. So it's cool what God's doing in this field. You're part of it. So are you ready to get into it? What we're going to look at today, as you've seen in the brochure that brought you here, are topics that more specifically relate to the issue of abuse. And certainly that's been a part of my history. If you know my story, I was sexually violated as a little boy at the hand of my alcoholic mother's lover. My mother was alcoholic, and while she was more than that, that consumed her life, and she died in a drink-driving accident when I was a child after my molestation episodes began. And then, of course, after her death, I was separated from my father, the most important source the little boy would derive the impartation of masculine identification from. And so by the time I was 7, all of this had happened to me. So how could there have ever been normality in my life when none had been invested? It's very easy to look at people whose lives are perverse and judge them, and our judgments may be correct that the way of life that they live misses God's mark and intent. But that's not the same as knowing what to do about it in ways that are redemptive, not just punitive. And so for me, my life went off track early because of these consequences and circumstances. And part of that, too, was the next tier of abuse began when I was a kid in school. And I grew up in the very conservative American Midwestern culture, where if you don't conform, you tend to be punished. So because I was soft and had not bonded with daddy, but had bonded after women who were raising me, you know, if you're a kid living in Atlanta, Georgia, you develop a southern accent, but you're not born with one. And if you're a kid growing up in London, you develop a UK accent. Not that you're born with one. And if you live here in New Zealand, you're not born with a Kiwi accent either. But you do cultivate it before you consciously recognize it. Because it's all that is reflected to you. In your environment, you imprint. In fact, we don't call children impressionable for nothing. Children are indeed neurologically, neurochemically, highly impressionable before they go through puberty. And when I was learning to read and write and speak, I was also learning the affectation of the only people I allowed in my heart, and that was female influences. Because after my mother's death, imagine before her death, I saw men as abusive. And then my father gave me a way to live in a more stable home environment following my mother's death, and he thought he was doing me a favor. But it's not what he intended that matters. I perceived abandonment. So abused and confused by an adult male, and then abandoned by the most important man in my life, you can understand that by the time I entered school, men either abused me or they abandoned me, and then my classmates added another layer. So the mannerisms that still some people see as off-putting are the lingering residual effect, the affectation or accent I acquired by learning it from women, the only people I allowed into my heart as they raised me, as my dad pursued a new career. And so classmates began to torment me. As C.S. Lewis says, you know, we're either helping people to God or away from God on the way that we treat them, by the way that we treat them, which is why the second commandment is the second commandment. And so what I experienced in school, beginning about the time I was 11, was, you know, the litany of sissy and queer and fag and failure as a man. So I got abuse coming to me in that direction. And then there were other boys who would also seek me out for sex as well. And so again, by the time I reached adulthood, the only relationships I knew with men, they beat me up or went to bed with me, basically. So how could I have arrived at any other destination than my homosexuality? And people say, well, it's a choice. Oh, no, it's not. Choice means informed choice, where I have options possible to consider, and weighing all the possibilities and options, I make that choice. That's not the kind of choice I was offered. I thought I had no choice. Everybody else seemed convinced I was gay. I believed them. That's why our words carry the power of life and death. They help shape our outcome. I wasn't gay as a high school student. I was confused, and I was vulnerable, and I was hungry for same-sex acceptance. It's a pity the only kind I knew was sexual. And so the words and treatment of others helped me arrive at that destination where I thought I had no choice. And so, I ended up embracing homosexuality, and I lived everything from the promiscuous gay lifestyle to later involvement in a gay church where I was the best man at the first gay wedding of two gay men in the state of Hawaii in 1976, who later became born again in spite of their gay theology. They did love God, and the Bible never said you had to be in a doctrinally correct environment to get saved. You just have to seek God with all of your heart in spite of wrong doctrine sometimes. And they ended up becoming born again and were the first to witness to me that a life beyond homosexuality was possible. I thought they were stark, raving mad because I knew the holy mantra. My ego defense was well entrenched. Born gay, can't change, shouldn't need to. Gay is good. And yet, I decided my way to be born again was through a sex change, which I did not have, but I tried. My doctors diagnosed me as a good candidate for surgery, and I began living as a woman and lived as such for 18 months before the Lord intervened in my life and opened my eyes to the rest of the story. He never said, stop being gay. He did say, walk with me. As I often say, the issue isn't heterosexuality versus homosexuality, because straight people go to hell. People don't go to hell because they're gay either. That's not what the Bible says. When the Bible says those who live like this do not inherit the kingdom of God, the issue is who you're bowing down to as Savior and Lord. That's what gets people into trouble. In other words, my need was not for a different sex life. My need was for a Savior. My problem was much deeper than who I went to bed with. That was just a surface symptom of my deepest need. And so many Christians did not know how to respond to me or witness to me. They kept trying to win an argument that the way I lived was wrong, as if I didn't know this. But what I didn't know was about the character of God who has a history over thousands of years of redeeming the sexual sinner. Rahab the hooker, Jesus comes from her family lineage. Samson misused his anointing and appointing from God and got into trouble sexually. And so did King David, who walked with God for decades before committing adultery and murder. And of course, also we know Mary Magdalene, the adulteress, and the woman at the well are three more bad girl illustrations in the New Testament that God yet intervened and redeemed them from their sexually sinful circumstances. And even Paul said 2,000 years ago, some of you here used to sleep around before you were married in this church in Corinth, and some of you here committed adultery, and some of you, you know, you were involved in the sex industry of pornography and prostitution, and some of you were homosexual, being used that way or using others that way, but you're not now because of Jesus. So this idea of sexual redemption isn't cutting edge or anything new to God. It's ancient stuff. It's just our turn in the wheel to get with it and make that known in church culture as we make disciples and as we reflect God and go tell that good news that God does also save the sexually wounded, the sinners, those missing his intent sexually. And so, as I often like to repeat a quote I've heard years ago, the opposite of homosexuality isn't heterosexuality. It is holiness, submission to God. And that's something all of us can achieve. Because I don't know if everybody with the same-sex attraction will ever reorient or not. Clinically and theoretically, it is possible and it is documented. But the fact of the matter is, whether a person ever goes straight is irrelevant to me. I care that their sexuality isn't their master and that they are submitted to the Lordship of Christ. And if they have to drag themselves to the cross every day, so what? It's better being God's slave than a slave to sexuality. And so, you know, when you do walk with God, well, things begin to get worked on. And in my own life, it's true. God began to bring cleansing to my defilement. He began to bring healing to damage. And we'll talk about that today, as well as he began to nourish my starved heart with healthy masculine love from men in God's family who were like God with skin on. God says he's a father to the fatherless, but that's not by being some intangible vapor. God tangibly loved me and compensated me. As Psalm 68 says, he puts the emotionally starved in the family. And I'm grateful that there were men in my church big enough whose egos were secure enough that they'd be seen in the restaurant with me, knowing they would be judged by virtue of association. Men who helped me buy better clothing and men who invited me to the men's group and the men's camp and the men's breakfast and the men's retreat, investing in my life and proving to me I had value to them without having to be sexual with them and that I could get love from them without having to go to bed with them. And when my fixation on men began to dissolve, and why did that fixation dissolve? My appetite got satisfied. I cried out to God for God to take away my same-sex attractions. God did not. What he did, he doesn't take away appetites and attractions. He addresses them properly. And as my appetite for masculine love was satisfied, well, you know how it is. When you're fasting, even a bag of salt looks pretty good. But you also know that when you are crammed full of good food, even the most tempting dessert tray loses its power to pull you in. And that's a psychological concept we find 3,000 years ago in Proverbs, where it says in Proverbs 27, verse 7, to a man who eats a really big meal, honey's not desirable anymore, but to a man who is starving, even the bitter thing will seem to taste sweet. In modern vernacular, bad love is better than no love at all. And so God doesn't take away appetite. He satisfies it rightly, like he said to the Samaritan woman living with her fifth sexual partner. He didn't criticize her for looking for love. Instead, he says, I know you're thirsty. This water at the well won't quench your deepest thirst. The inference is, neither will your lover. However, I've got the real bread. I've got the real water. And if you would feed on that, then your deepest need would be satisfied. This is the God we serve who gets it. And that's why he's our advocate that we can look to. And so as God began to nourish my soul, then my fixation on men began to dissolve. And that's when I discovered girls. I tell people it's a dreadful thing to go through puberty twice, but that's basically psychodynamically what happened. So, just to give you some perspective, if you would, Nadia, go ahead and put up this next image, if you would, please. I'd like to give people here perspective. That's a picture of, it's a little washed out there, but we're going to work on that later. Picture of my wonderful wife of 22 years, Karen, and my lovely 19-year-old daughter, Gracie. And you know, the fact that I'm a husband and a father doesn't prove I'm not gay. Because, you know, when I was based in North America years ago in a counseling service, about 30% of my clients, they were married men living double lives. So I don't put this up as proof I'm not gay. I hold it forth, though, as evidence that as you grow, things change. And what was once unattainable and undesirable became both. 5-year-old can't drive a car. 15-year-old can learn. 25-year-old can navigate one pretty good in spite of risk. And so the fact of the matter is, what was once undesirable and unattainable became both. As you grow, things change. But if you would go backward, I'd like them to see the picture, the before picture, just to give people perspective. Can you find that one for me? Oh yes, some of you know what I'm going to put up here. Go ahead and pop that up there. That was me when I met the Lord 26 years ago. Yes, I know, it was a lot of work. And I don't put it up there because I'm proud of it. In fact, I destroyed the image once upon a time, and a famous Christian leader said, get a copy from the negative because you know you're going to have a platform around the world one day, Si, and a picture's worth a thousand words. And so, you know, I realize that when people look at me, they see the residue of my history. And as I said last night, okay, well, I got residue, you overlook mine, and I'll overlook yours. Because we all have residue. Because the blood of Jesus, if you've been born again for 10 minutes, you know he'll wash away your guilt and sin, not your memory, and not your history, and not your humanity and its vulnerabilities. Those are the things we're mopping up as we reckon making Christ the Lord in our lives. Because you don't make him Lord once, you make him Lord every day in the choices that you make. So with this in mind, you know, when I began going to church years ago, I was much closer to that image than the heterosexual stallion you see before you today. And so, you know, metaphorically, I may walk with a limp, but the miracle of God is I walk at all, considering my legs got cut out from underneath me. So it's nice to be able to say that, yeah, I got scars, and you know, scars are better than open wounds that continue to cripple your function. We'll talk about how those wounds got mended today. That though I'll never live like the past never happened, I have been able to live a life beyond it. And that's what we want to be talking about. So that's a little bit of my history so that you will understand that I do understand. You can take her down. Ding dong, the witch is dead. Anyway. Now, are we ready? What we want to do is we want to take a look this morning at three areas of real concern and complaint against God's workers. Please understand, I am a pastor. I've been a Christian worker for, as mentioned, 25 years this July. I work with church culture all the time, and the last thing I want to do is be critical of pastors. They got a big plate of responsibility, and they are limited human beings doing the best they know how. My desire is to serve you if you are a Christian worker, not to be critical of you. I'm on your side. But it is useful to sometimes look at the negative so that we can better find that positive. And so when it comes to sexual sin, we want to look at three key areas in our first session this morning where church culture has been missing it and why it's important we recognize the negative so that we can do better than that. Would you agree? I love God who paints with darkness. In the realm of art, I'm a graphic artist, and in the realm of art, it's called the chiaroscuro effect, where you paint with darkness and a little illumination goes a lot further. So let's not be afraid to look at the complaints that I get from people on a grassroots level in church after church, group after group, congregation after congregation. I'm the public one that people come to with their complaints. I'm the one they write an email. I'm the one where I hear this pattern again and again and again and again so frequently and across the denominational boards that it's like, well, we need to be talking about this because apparently there are blank spots in understanding that need to be spelled out that we can go forward and do better. Now who here, whether you're a professional or not, who here is in people serving ministry? Yep, thank you for being here. I know you're busy and I appreciate you sacrificing time to be here. So let's take a look at the first complaint. My first complaint would be an unredemptive attitude. Now unredemptive attitude, when I think of that, I think of situations where, well, for example, I used to host TV and radio programs years ago in the United States, and we used to have talkback segments and things like that, and one day a gentleman telephoned in live on air with a weapon to his head. He said, I've been a born-again believer for 22 years. I go to a spirit-filled church that prides itself on having all the answers, cutting-edge solutions for today's issues. And he said he had same-sex attractions. And he knew, as an even evangelical Bible-believing believer, that God did not want him living homosexually. But that did not make his feelings go away. Just because you're born again doesn't mean your feelings have changed. And so, you know, he was struggling with his same-sex attractions, and he was frustrated by this. And he had been frustrated for 22 years, which is a pretty long time to have this languishing in your life, and he would pray his brains out, but it wouldn't go away, and he didn't know what to do, but he decided finally he would open up his mouth and confess his struggle to someone on the pastoral team. He decided he would do this on a Sunday after service when people were available for ministry at the altar. So, you know, he worked up enough courage and he walked on down, you know, and he was about ready to open his mouth and share his struggle when one of the associate pastors said to another associate pastor some derogatory comments against gay people. There had been some pro-gay event in town that weekend on the Saturday or the Friday, and so everybody was stirred up. And so, you know, he was just about ready to open up and confess his struggle, and there he heard his own leadership team making these derogatory comments. And I don't know, maybe he overreacted, maybe he was a bit self-pitying, but you know what, after 22 years, this was the final straw on the demoralized camel's back. Goes to show you, you never know who around you is struggling. Because you know what? Most homosexual people are not like I am. You would never know their struggle. They're behind a carefully polished mask, and their outward behavior demonstrates normality. You don't know what's going on behind people's masks. And so, you know, he felt completely demoralized by this. He went home, and he was going to kill himself. He was sitting in front of the television, and it was turned off, and the Lord said, turn on the TV. And of course, as I always say, it's got to be pretty desperate for God to ever suggest you turn on television. And so he turned on the TV, and he heard me preaching that message from 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verses 9 through 11, where some of you used to be like that, but you're not now. He said, why did I have to wait 22 years to hear a simple biblical illustration that has inspired hope in my heart about God's character on this issue that any Bible college graduate should have been able to offer me? And I said, you're absolutely right. I'm really sorry, but I'm glad you heard it now. Now, you know, I just got to see him. After moving back to America, I got to run into that man not that long ago, and he's doing all right. In fact, he's in ministry. Fact of the matter is, though, that day that he heard me, I didn't change him. What I did was I encouraged him about God's character in a way that up to this point, church culture hadn't. And then when they did talk about it, it was from the, we got to get them and God's got to stop them, instead of God wants to save them. And I realized that what's going on in New Zealand culture and church culture, and I realized what's going on, you know, in Western world generally, and especially in political years, where we kind of get indignant about stuff like the pro-gay effort. And I want to say something. If you get indignant, it's one thing to react to a lie being promoted as truth. We all react to that, understandably. That's different than how we react to people. Even if you think they are our enemies, how are you supposed to respond to your enemies? When Jesus Christ came to earth 2,000 years ago, the Jewish religious people wanted Jesus to get those Roman pagans because their policies were oppressing God's people. Is that right? And they got ticked off at Jesus because he didn't. Jesus didn't go after the Romans and their pagan policies. He criticized his own people for failing to represent God's character effectively. And I think we're kind of like that about right now in culture. One thing to react against a lie promoted as truth, but how we handle people is another matter. Policy is one thing, people are another thing. So having said this, let me give you this illustration from Melbourne, Australia. I've been working in Australia, like New Zealand, for 18 years. That's given me a little bit of time to observe changes in culture and in church culture too, and that's been cool to live long enough to have seen this as a contributor. And I remember in this really massive church in Melbourne, I was sharing my story. Gay activists turned out that night. They were mad at me. And they marched into that place, you know, and the Christian church had turned out in mass, and gay people from community were there too to hear what I was going to say. And then there were the activists from Gays and Lesbians Against Discrimination, or GLAAD. They always have the best acronyms, you must admit it. And they turned out dressed in black, and they had their torches, and the national news was there, and it looked like it could be a circus, and I did not know what to do. And so I prayed, and I said, you know, we've got activists here, and we've got people from the community here, and I said, you know, these activists, they're anti-discrimination, and I said, I know what discrimination feels like. I've lived in that atmosphere since I can consciously remember. I still am the conference speaker people look at with contempt until they realize I am the speaker. And so I know what discrimination feels like. And I said, it always hurts, and I'm not here about discrimination. And I said, if you're a Christian and you feel that we have not loved our neighbor as ourself, that we have not loved our enemies, if you feel that we owe God an apology for failing the second commandment, and we owe them an apology for not loving them. We'd rather win an argument than win a neighbor. Well, would you stand with me in prayer? And the whole church stood with me in a very dramatic, genuine moment, where had it not been genuine, the gay community would have intuited it. And so we led them through prayer. Well, of course, they stayed and let me share without interruption. They even, you know, stayed for cookies and coffee afterward, and we entered into a little meaningful dialogue. And when it was all said and done, the pastors at the door were shaking hands as people left, and the two activists who were there who could have made that night a nightmare with one little edict. These were people who threw paint on members of parliament and who burned furniture in the streets of Melbourne. They were not afraid to make it a rough night. But instead, when the pastor said, thanks for coming, thanks for staying and letting Cy share his heart and knowing our hearts, the activist said, no, we want to thank you. We were wrong about you. We thought that this, in a political year, was another anti-gay Bible-bashing event to stir up an attitude against us, and we realized we were wrong about you. That even if we don't agree with every point of view offered here tonight, we know you care about people like us, and in our gay community here in the inner city, when there are people who have questions of a spiritual nature, we know a church in the city we can send them to, where they will be respected and understood, and we won't give you trouble anymore, and they haven't 10 years later. Now that's the difference between trying to be right versus treating your neighbor like you'd like. Because you know what one thing evangelical Christians haven't done yet? We've never said sorry. We keep saying, you're wrong, yeah, I know you had trouble in your life, but you're still wrong, instead of saying, yeah, we're sorry you had trouble in your life, and we're sorry some of that trouble came from our camp. Don't you see, whenever the people of God sin, God always requires it to be reckoned with. One generation fails. What did God require of the new king? He had to step in and identify with the sin and name it and make it right. We're not saying what they do is right. We're saying, what about the log in our eye versus the speck in theirs? Isn't that the counsel Christ gives us? Redemptive attitude is very important. Because you know what I've observed in 40 years of gay versus straight polarity? Trying to win the argument hasn't won anybody. It's just deepened the divide. So you don't have to agree with my view. That's my view. You think about it and you talk to God about it and see what he says. I'm not saying we don't have to make policies and sometimes draw a line in the sand. How we do it is what matters. Okay? Now, in fact, let me give you an illustration too of a pastor. He, on a more personal level, he lived next door to this gay couple. This is in Latin America, this big macho pastor. I love to work in Latin America and I've been doing it for years, and this big pastor came up to me and he says, I live next door to this gay couple, and I realize that maybe my attitude has been wrong. And I said, well, what's been going on? And he says, well, this gay couple, you know, they'll be working in their garden and I'll be out there in mine, and they'll say, hi, pastor, and I'll glare to let them know God doesn't approve. I said, okay. And then he said, you know, and they'll come home from the market holding hands, and I'll drive by and they'll say, hi, pastor. And I'll kind of glare still to let them know God still doesn't approve. And I said, okay. Because he said, you know, I'm afraid that if I'm nice, they're going to think I'm approving of what they do. And I said, oh, well, I don't know that they got that idea. But anyway, you know, he says, well, I realize that maybe my approach hasn't been exactly very productive. And I said, okay, well, I said, now you tried one approach and you've seen that hadn't worked, so that gives you freedom to try something different. I don't know, maybe be nice, see where it goes. And I said to him, what if this was just a straight couple shacking up and living in sexual sin? What would you and your wife do to reach out to them? I mean, you know, you expect pagans to act like pagans, right? Even if we got God living in us, we can barely do the will of God. Why do we expect people without God to try? We shouldn't be surprised. And so with this in mind, what would you and your wife do to reach out to a pagan heterosexual couple living in sexual sin? He said, I don't know. We'd probably invite them over for dinner. I said, bingo. And he said, and I said, oh, don't be such a baby. It's just people. People who need people, they're the luckiest people in the world. So anyway, redemptive attitude is always profoundly more important than winning the argument that people are right. What's it say in Romans chapter 1? You hear the big, long diatribe beginning around verse 18 against homosexuality. True? But you know what? There was no punctuation or chapter separation from Romans chapter 1 through Romans chapter 2. And what are the first four verses of Romans chapter 2? Where Paul makes a statement about homosexuality in Romans chapter 1 as a cultural phenomenon. He then, comma, and those of you who would judge them, remember, in God's eyes, you're no different, so don't be smug. How often that part isn't retained in the preaching on that issue from Romans 1. So I'm not saying it's okay. I'm saying the speck in their eye isn't the issue. It's the log in ours, as is always God's approach with his people historically. Would you agree? Redemptive attitude. Redemption doesn't mean we say it's okay. Redemption means when people's lives are off track, we want to see God's best realized. And the best way that that can be realized is through submission to Christ. And there's where we want to invite people into that. That thus the Spirit has access to their inner world and begins reclaiming it if it isn't His, and begins to put it back on track if it's been derailed. Would you agree? That's right. First things first, not the argument, the relationship. Then the Spirit does the convicting. Second concern. Now, obviously, I don't need to belabor this first point because you're here, not because you got a bad attitude or you wouldn't be in this room. But we are also putting this down for posterity, and so we want it to be available in concept to others. But you're here because you care about people, or you wouldn't bother darkening the door. And that brings us, though, to the second concern, I find, and as a complaint against Christian workers, it is ineffective ministry. Doesn't matter if you have a good heart, it's not good enough. Doesn't matter if you have a burden, it's not good enough. You know, if you need open heart surgery, do you want someone who cares about you to do the surgery, or would you personally prefer someone with skill? Okay? It's one thing for someone to be burdened that you are treated. It's another thing that they know how to treat you. King David, he said, you know, God, I want you to give me men of wonderful character, nobility, and valor, but I'd also like them to be skilled when I have to go out there onto the battlefield, frankly. I think it's that kind of approach we're looking at here. Of course it matters that we care about people, and of course we ought to be burdened if we're in people caring. And whenever you've got someone in your own family situation who's got a problem in an area like this, then suddenly we do get volunteered for a burden that we might have never otherwise cared to know about. God's very good at volunteering His people to know things they would have never chosen to know. And so with this in mind, it's great that we have a burden, but we want to be a little more informed that we can be more effective. Because there's been a lot of wacko stuff go on in the name of Jesus in attempting to help people, and they are not helped. Would you agree? So when I think of ineffective ministry, I think of a failure to understand human dynamics and the way that God works in addressing. We have to remember that God takes time to teach His church culture lessons. Whatever knowledge we might have had once upon a time has been lost, and we have to recapture it again. This is a historical fact. And for example, in the 1970s, the charismatic movement swept through much of church culture around the world, and the attitude was, all you need is a dose of the ghost and you'll be set for life. And yet then people with the Holy Ghost began having moral failures. And then, of course, it was in the 1980s, word of faith movement. Knowing the word and how to use it and having faith that God will back it up and do it, that's what you need to have the victory in Jesus. And then people with the word of faith movement also had their moral failures too. It's not that the Holy Spirit doesn't help, and it's not that the Word and faith in God's character don't help. Of course, they're essential. It's that that doesn't get rid of your humanity. You still have to learn how to manage it. And so in the 1990s, we had enough black eyes and bloody noses through all of these scandals and shameful problems that we began to realize there must be something missing here that we need to know, and people began asking the right questions. How come I'm walking with God and supposedly a new creation, and why am I still messing with this? And why does it take such a long time to get over these problems? And how do I retrain my brain when it obviously takes more than memorizing the scriptures? What does Jesus do to redeem fallen sexuality? And how do I make Jesus the Lord over memory and history and my present struggles? These questions are real and people ask them, but there haven't been answers. There have been a lot of blank spots and hype masquerading as theology. How about just one scripture, 2 Corinthians 5:17. If any man is in Jesus, he becomes a new creation. The old life passes away and all things become new. And how in the 1980s and 90s that was misconstrued to infer this by some church cultures, that if you're in Jesus, everything is instantly transformed as if you'd never been fallen, was the inference. And therefore you shouldn't struggle with anything that was related to your past because everything is now made new. Now that's a lie. That's wishful thinking. In the original Greek language and tense of verb in the grammar, called the perfect tense, it says this: in Christ, transformation has been initiated and will continue transforming you. Now, isn't that a little more realistic? It's like a woman being pregnant. The first day you're pregnant, you are pregnant. But as that pregnancy continues, the transformation process becomes increasingly evident. God impregnates us by His Spirit, and the transformation process isn't finished, it is just begun. And over time, it will unfold, accomplishing its work. That's the inference of this scripture. And you know what? What I just said in the last 45 to 50 seconds is more than many people have heard on that one verse, and thus they have labored under a burden God never intended. Because you know what? If you were a new creation, as if you'd never been fallen, you wouldn't grow old, get sick, and die. And so consequently, we've had this lack of understanding, blank spots. For example, a woman comes to the office and she suffers from depression. And as a pastor, knowing the word, spiritual dynamics, I will respond to her from a pastor's point of view. Nothing wrong with that. But you know what? Just because I'm a pastor doesn't mean I'm a therapist. And just because I know God doesn't mean God has told me everything. Yet many Christians labor under a mistaken burden that I must have answers for every situation that ever crosses my path, and that God knows everything, and thus he's got to let me know everything about every situation. And that's not anywhere inferred in Scripture. God does know everything, but how he uses us and to what degree, to what openness we have an understanding, that's another matter. And so it is, the woman comes to my office as a pastor, I'm going to look at her from a Christian worldview, from a biblical model, and I'm going to say, maybe there's some unresolved issue in her life, like unforgiveness, some spiritual theme that is not reckoned with yet, and thus she is not able to make progress. Or maybe there's a generational sin, or maybe there's a demonic influence here where she's blocked. Whatever, my worldview may be accurate, but not exclusively and absolutely completely. Because I take the same depressed woman and I send her to a psychiatrist. And because a psychiatrist is medically trained, he's not just a therapist, he's a doctor with additional training about the way the psyche works and how neurochemistry works and where personality is embedded in the brain and chemistry, he understands these ramifications in a way that pastors are not trained to understand. And so consequently, he may not say, tell me about your troubled childhood yet. He may simply ask her a very straightforward question. What's your diet like and how much sleep do you get? Because medically trained people understand if you don't get enough sleep and you don't eat the right foods, brain chemistry is eventually thrown out of balance and you can suffer clinical depression for no other reason than just bad temple management. You know, when God said you gotta have a Sabbath, he didn't make it a suggestion or a recommendation. You know, like when you get everything else in your busy agenda finished, then consider a Sabbath. I think he insisted and made it commandment, not as law, but as love. Because knowing how busy, capable people made in the image of God can be, God also knows that we need to cool our jets and get rest and replenishment at least one day out of the week. Unfortunately, modern Christians tend to cram everything else into their Sabbath. They didn't bother to get done all the rest of the days. And so that can only go on so long. When you don't get enough sleep, sleep is never written off by your body. If you don't get enough sleep, brain chemistry is not only thrown out of balance and you can't manage stress well, but also then you begin to suffer immune suppression. And it's like your body's way of having a fail-safe. If you don't volunteer for sleep, your body will shut down one level of immune protection so that you will get sick and your body says, no, I insist. And so that's the way it works. Pay now or pay later. You volunteer or you get volunteered, you will get rest. But what happens, many people who suffer clinical depression, their entire sleep cycle is thrown out of balance. And so that's why the doctor will want to know before he delves into the psyche. He wants to know how is the temple being managed. And then we send the same depressed woman to a social worker who will say, well, child, no wonder you're depressed. Your husband ran off and left you in an adulterous relationship. You got 5 kids to raise. You got to hold down 2 jobs to pay the bills. We got to intervene with some social services here to lift that burden so you can catch your breath again. Now, you know what? All 3 approaches to this woman may be accurate and necessary. The problem with Christian ministry very often is that we don't consider the whole person and the complete community approach. So we just look at a very narrow wedge. Every issue is spiritual and moral, and that's not true. It may include that, but it is not limited to it. Making sense? So my job as a pastor isn't to have all the answers. It's to know how to help a person. And knowing how to help a person may mean knowing my community resources so that I can make an informed referral so that the person is helped. That's the goal, not that our church only knows everything. So it's a better day, and we're beginning to become more aware of these concerns, thank God, but it's still worth spelling out. And then, of course, I think of demons. Now, some church cultures are too sophisticated to believe in that kind of superstitious stuff. And dispensationalists might say it's not that era anymore. And then there are those who are looking for demons under every rock and in every corner. And so somewhere in the middle, I suppose, there is balance. But the fact is, Jesus ministered to the reality of demons, yes. So we need to talk about it too, and having lived in Asia for years, I saw demonic influences in a more straightforward way than we have in our more sophisticated and masked Voltairean, away from God, science rational Western first world culture. Having said it, I don't look for demons everywhere, but if people are infected, so they are. And that's my take on demonic activity. In fact, there is no word in the Bible for, you know, oppressed or possessed. There was one biblical term, to be demonized. It conveys the same concept of infected. Now, don't you tell me a Christian can't have a demon. You don't have to agree with me, but I have the microphone and it is my seminar. But let me tell you why I believe this way. Are you a believer here today? Can you get the flu? I rest my case. The Holy Ghost of life and power lives in your body, and you know what? So what? You live in a world where you're at risk. Alien, hostile life forces look for an opening in a host. You can't see them, taste them, touch them, feel them. Doesn't matter. They're real. And they enter into your body through a natural opening or through an injury. And you still don't feel them enter your body, but they do. And they begin to set up a colony through multiplying. And eventually that colony, over 3 days to 2 weeks, that colony begins to exert influence and your body's alarms go off and you go to war to take captive what's trying to multiply and take you captive. Would you say that's a pretty good description of infection? And I think if it's true for the body, it's true for the soul, which is why we are poorer Christians in our theology when we don't understand biology, because God says he gives us material illustrations that help us understand the very real but yet intangible invisible world. Consequently, alien, hostile life forces look for an opening in a host, a wound, an opportunity where they were given permission and a foothold, and they take root and begin to multiply, like an infection. Now, some infections are localized. A little bit of rubbing alcohol there on a cut takes care of it. A little bit of maintenance will do in a world of risk. But at the same time, some infections are so systemic, like strep throat or malaria, that a little bit of mouthwash and gargle in the bathroom will not kill the infection. I have to step outside and submit myself to doctor care to get antibiotic to boost my system to take back authority over what's trying to gain authority over it. Making sense? And so, for example, when it comes to ministry in the area of the demonic, have you ever heard people say, I don't understand what's wrong. I went through deliverance and I felt such relief. I felt such release. But now, 2 years later, I'm struggling all over again with this. If you haven't heard it yet, you will. And here's what often happens. For example, if I'm a farmer working in a field filled with mud and manure, no big drama. If I get cut, where you understand, I might get exposed to germs. But if I don't treat that, then after a period of weeks, I may have a big boil and, you know, septicemia traveling down my arm. And so I can't move my hand. The swelling is so bad, I've lost mobility of my limb. And I go to the doctor and and the doctor says, poor baby, well, we'll fix it. And he lances it open and all the pus comes out. And he washes it and washes it and washes it. And boy, in 30 minutes, the swelling is down. I feel relief and release. I've got mobility and function again. But what happens if the doctor sends me out the door and he doesn't close the injury and cover it and give me antibiotic? In a world of microbes, I'm vulnerable to reinfection. That'd be poor, ineffective treatment, would you agree, on the part of a doctor who only gave me half the appropriate treatment? And I find when it comes to demonic deliverance, demons are just the infection. They're the secondary problem. They're the symptom of the deeper need, which is the opening that allowed it to begin with. And so we may have authority in the name of Jesus to cast out a demon and wash out that infectious agent. But even Jesus said when dealing with demons, you can blow the dirt out the door, but if you don't shut the door, the dirt blows right back in. And so this idea is that even if we have effective ministry in the anointing and name of Jesus and his authority, that's not good enough. It's not just to sweep the dirt out. You've got to shut the door, or you've offered half a ministry, and thus, no matter how well anointed and intended, it is therefore ineffective. Does that make sense? So we want to take a look at the whole person so that our ministry approach will be more effective, so that we can understand not just what people do, but why, so that our approach will be informed. Okay. Third complaint against Christian workers is it's a tie. It's a three-way tie. It's a betrayal of confidence, lack of authenticity, lack of integrity. I'll say it again. Three-way tie for the third complaint. It's a lack of authenticity, lack of integrity, and a betrayal of confidence. Let's start with betrayal of confidence. Now, you know the law in your country. If you're a counselor, you most likely do, or a pastor. But not everybody is on the same page, which is why I cannot take it for granted for our purposes right now that you know this. So forgive me if you do. But when is it right that you betray a confidence when somebody comes to you and confesses something to you? When is it legally right for you to betray that? Do you know? When they're going to hurt themselves or someone else. You want to stay with that answer? Or do you want to trade that in for what's behind door number two? No, you're right. Absolutely. When you are going to hurt yourself or someone else. If someone comes to me, and I've had it happen. One time a client called me up and said, you can cancel my future bookings. I've overdosed and I won't be back. Click. And so I got on the phone, in the U.S., you know, 911. I can't remember here. What do you dial? There you go. You need to know it. And so I rang the number. I turned in my client. I betrayed that confidence. And so the medical crew went over to her house, and indeed she had overdosed, and it could have been a lethal amount. And had I not intervened just to protect her ego, then she could have died, and I would have been liable. And so I turned her in. She was mad at me for a year. They took her away, and they put her in a mental institution, and they evaluated her, and they treated her. And she got better, and now she's glad she got an opportunity to live. But at the time, she didn't appreciate it. And so my job was to be bigger than nice. And my job was to be more important than protecting her ego from others knowing her weakness. It was to see her life spared when she didn't know enough to act rightly. And so when somebody threatens suicide, and it's one thing for someone to say, sometimes I just feel like giving up or giving in. Sometimes people say, you know, every now and then I've had these dark thoughts of suicide. That's not the same as somebody saying, I'm going to kill myself. But yet we all do, if we're in counseling, need training in the management of suicide risk. Because as we know about New Zealand, it ranks number one in the industrialized world for suicides. And so I wonder if that might be the fruit of a secularized culture that thinks there is no greater purpose in life than material acquisition and self-indulgence, and then you die and face oblivion. But when you have a purpose in God, you can get through any dark tunnel knowing that somehow, someway, someday, I'll turn the corner and life will get better and it's worth hanging on to until I get there. Big difference, would you agree? So when people talk about suicide, I want to hear that and evaluate it. But whenever they say they're going to do something, you got to take action. Even if it does get them into trouble temporarily, it buys them an opportunity for life. Then, second reason, you also said, well, when they're going to hurt somebody else. If somebody in my office leaves angry and I think they're going to go home and they're going to beat up that spouse or something like that, I got to call. I got to intervene. Because they're not thinking rationally. And so we want to give them an opportunity for intervention. It doesn't mean they're going to be arrested and hauled off to jail. It could. But usually what happens is police are trained in domestic violence situations to know how to ratchet down the pressure. Their goal isn't to be punitive. It is to intervene until common sense is achieved again. And so sometimes we are a part of that process. Agreed? But now what about sexual abuse? Did you know that right now in Western culture, New Zealand is a part of this. One in every four women and one in every six boys will be sexually violated before the age of 12. That means in a church of 100 people, there are 25 women and there are 18 men who are dealing with this as a history. It's one of the least addressed issues in church culture that needs to be, because it is the foundation for so many other outworkings of sexual problems. And yet, here we have so rarely addressed it, which is why we're going to make emphasis on it today. So, you know we're going through the great big scandals in Western culture, too, about the Catholic Church molestation issues and the Michael Jackson case. It's all out there, isn't it? And it's not bad that culture is talking about it. We can't afford to be naive with who's minding the children. And the average pedophile will molest between 80 to 300 children before being stopped. And historically, here's what church culture has done. Somebody comes into our church, and pedophiles like church culture because we're pretty naive. We are usually giving people the benefit of the doubt. And even if people have had issue, we often think, well, now they're born again, they're new creations, and in the name of Jesus, we need to extend mercy and give people a second chance. And that all sounds really, really good theoretically, except in application historically with the pedophile. And pedophiles are very adept at working with children. They have a giftedness, and they often relate better on that level. And I'm not talking about teenagers messing around. I'm talking about adults with a sexual orientation toward children. Okay? When you talk to the police, the real concern is children under 12. It's not that children under 16 aren't concerned, but identity foundations have generally been established after the age of 12. The impact is different. And so the fact is, little children, they get sexually violated and their lives are permanently changed. In fact, there's a brilliant article called The Neurobiology of Childhood Sexual Abuse, as was written in the March 2003 issue of Scientific American magazine. And brain-related research has revealed that when children are sexually violated or physically abused, especially under the age of 12, brain patterns are set that never correct. Now, it doesn't mean that the kid is screwed up forever. That's not the implication, and they don't paint that picture. But they do portray consequences, which we will look at later today, so that we can understand what people are up against. If they're going to go forward, they got to know what the obstacles are, and we need to know them too. And so, the average pedophile will go into church culture, work with young people, and then will begin to groom them to have access to be sexual. The grooming may take time. And, for example, many church cultures will bring someone in and they'll begin to get rumor that something's going on. They'll confront the pedophile and the pedophile will end up leaving that church and leaving that community, but he's never called into account and thus will go to another community and repeat the same cycle. And this is where we have to be better at holding people accountable. This is the loving approach. And so, you know, as a person who has had to turn people into the police because they have confessed to me they are having sex with children, men that I have had to see go to jail for up to 25 years. Do you think that makes me feel good? Of course not. But I have to do something better than be polite. I have to protect people. And so that's why when anybody would ever come to my office and open their mouth, and here I'm not a clinical therapist, I'm a pastoral counselor. But yet I can still be a better and more responsible one. And so what happens is, when you would come into my office for a pastoral or a meeting, before you ever opened your mouth and got to talk to me, you had to sign a contract. And one of those contracts that you signed, it mentioned that if you open your mouth and tell me that you're going to hurt yourself, someone else, or you're having sex with minors, I will be required to report that to an investigative process or to the authorities for intervention. And you know that before opening your mouth, but you know what? I'm not required by law to have that. I just had it to be polite. And so, you know what? Those men opened up their mouth and told me anyway. You know what that tells me? They wanted someone to stop them because they didn't have the inner ability to stop themselves. And those men have later written me from jail and they have said, thank you for stopping me. Thank you for turning me in. Thank you that I am now not abusing more children, and thank you that God's dealing with me here and now, and I'm getting treatment so that I don't have to face judgment later. And you know what? I have the privilege of knowing that there are kids who have reached young adulthood today, and they are not victims of abuse that would have been their outcome had I not intervened to be a brother's keeper. Because sometimes there's no pain-free answer, there's just the right answer. Would you agree? It's messy, but it's much messier if we don't intervene to be a brother's keeper. In fact, the law actually says in the United States that if I even think you're having sex with a minor, I'm required to report it. And if I don't, I am liable. And the goal of this law is not to be punitive and punish pedophiles. It is to stop them and get them treatment and stop the cycle of abuse in the community. It is a right law. Okay? Pedophiles historically don't stop themselves, according to clinical research. And any redeemed pedophile will be the first to tell you, don't you ever trust me. Don't you ever put me in work with children. Don't you ever let me say to you, I'm okay now, and that's under the blood, and I'm doing better now, and I've got this gifting, put me to work there. Don't you ever believe that. A redeemed pedophile would be the first to say to you, don't trust that. You hold me accountable, and you don't ever give me that opportunity. And so, having to deal with these issues isn't always nice, but there's where we understand it is appropriate to betray confidence under these circumstances so that people are protected. In fact, you can do background checks now, and if your church doesn't do background checks on staff, I would advise you to start. Because it's expensive, but it's much more expensive if you don't. A church in my state just had the youth worker arrested. The youth worker was inviting young boys over to his home for sleepovers, and he was having sex with them. Of course, this is a scandal and a shocker, but you know what's the bigger scandal and bigger shocker and the much bigger liability? If they did not do a background check, they are liable, because they could have found out that historically he already had been charged with this once upon a time. Why didn't they do a background check? All of that would have been avoided. Secondly, if they did do the background check and still hired him, they're still liable. In other words, they're not off the hook one way or the other. Ignorance or deliberately, they should have never allowed him in that position. And so they are in trouble. And we don't want that to be our lot, now do we? We got to know who's minding the children. And you know, it's so sad. So many youth workers and child care workers are undeserving of any shadow of suspicion. It's sad to have to be so suspicious, but better that we are than be naive and wish we had been. And so that's why it's a pastor myself, I would not have one person ever working with the kids. Two or three always, where somebody's covering somebody else's back. You think that's inconvenient to get that kind of staff rustled up? It's a lot more inconvenient to wish you had. You know, there's no easy answer. There's just the right answer. So betrayal of confidence is when we are allowed, there is the circumstance with abuse and the harming of a person or another that we can violate confidentiality. But the other issues that you see, the lack of authenticity. Now, I make a career out of sharing my dirt. I share how God has helped me deal with the issue of masturbation in my life. I share how God's helped me deal with my dirty thought life and get it back on track and become Lord over it. I share with people how God brought healing to my wounded heart and how God brought me out of a sexual slavery. I talk about my history only because God has asked me to be a living letter, and I realize He doesn't ask that of everybody. And also, there's much I don't talk about, and I am very circumspect when I do talk because I've got to protect people, including family. Okay? So as much as you think I make disclosure, there's a lot that I don't say. And you need to think those things through before you speak it from the pulpit, because once you say it, you can't take it back, really. But with this in mind, I think one thing that has enabled me to connect very well with my largest market now of 18 to 30, the emerging church, the emerging market that is now my larger audience, that the 18 to 30-year-old crowd, here's what I've observed about them. And if you're 18 to 30, you'll know what I'm saying. You can go online and find any different biblical point of view or doctrinal view. You can go online and find 15 different points of view about a particular teaching. There are books and tapes and CDs and DVDs and resources available that people hardly even need to go to church to hear a sermon, because all this stuff is so widely available. You can download sermons online all the time. The point being, in the pulpit, I'm finding increasingly people don't care about what they need to be taught as much as how that truth is applied in a person's life. If you're not struggling with your dirty thoughts anymore, how is that so? And don't you tell me not to masturbate. You tell me how God helped you not to masturbate, and then I'll consider that application in my life. I find a younger generation is a little bit more critical in their thinking, and they want life application of truth, not just theory, presented to them as what we're supposed to believe and do. So if you want to have authority in a person's life, increasingly in church culture, you have to be authentic. Authenticity equals having authority. That's what I've discovered. And so this is a very different model than many of us in church culture are used to. Because we're used to this is what the Word of God says, and let's line up with it and do it. Nothing wrong with that, but we need to take it one step further and say, this is what the Word of God says, and this is how God has made it real in my life, because I can only comfort you with the comfort I've derived from God. Authenticity has been lacking in a lot of church leadership, especially in the area of sexual struggle. We'll give people financial advice. We'll talk to people about managing their children. And we'll give people the moral lecture, according to Christianity Today magazine. About 80% of pastors say they do a once-a-year sermon on sexual sin, but usually it's around the just don't do it unless you're married, and if you are married, God made sex, and it's good. And people already know this and need more than that, because that information is not preventing Christians from demonstrating a rate of sexual activity about like the pagan world in first world Western church culture. We got to do better than that. People got to know, as shepherds of the flock, what works for you, and how did you make Jesus Lord, and how did Jesus heal your broken heart, and how did you renew your mind, and how is all of that theory real for you, or I don't want to know. That's the way it seems to be increasingly. Anybody here under 30? Would you agree? And that's why my messages are packaged in the lessons learned. I'm not telling you what to do with your life. I'm telling you what God did in mine. You consider it, and if it rings true, you try it and see if it works. That's the authentic approach people are interested in today, especially in the sex stuff. Okay? The one thing that we're scared to admit that we might actually wrestle with, as if any of us don't. And then, integrity. We're going to take a look at this whole issue in our next session, because before we deal with other people, we want to make sure that we can stay on track in a world of risk. Having been in full-time ministry for 25 years, having come close to burnout a couple of times, don't you know the devil would love to make me fall? Don't you know I've had opportunities to be tempted and come under pressure? Don't you know I'm weak and vulnerable, a wounded healer filled with frailty? Now, why haven't I gone off track in a world of risk? I want to talk with you about some of my strategy, if that would be of interest, because I want you to make it as a caregiver and as a servant of the Lord. But I find Christian leadership, I think it's what, every year there's something like 2,000 leaders fall? What was Scripture telling us 2,000 years ago? In your effort to help other people, don't become entangled in sin with them. That's the Jewish way of saying you're at risk and you very well might be entangled. So before we talk about other people, if you're going to deal in the arena of sexual sin, there are certain ways you need to gear up that are different from just any other kind of counseling. Because I don't offer financial management counseling. I don't offer parenting a two-year-old kind of counseling. I don't do interior decor kind of counseling, although I could, but that's another story. So the fact is, I deal with the sex stuff, and it's dark and dirty with deep, strong currents. You know, if you're a nurse and you work on the infectious disease, or rather if you're a nurse and you work on the general floor, how you protect yourself is one thing, but when you're working in the infectious disease ward, you have to take a whole new level of precaution, agreed? That just because you're the healthy one doesn't mean that you are risk-free. By virtue of those with whom you associate, you're putting yourself at heightened risk. That's why it's so important that you gown up and glove up and mask up and then scrub down when it's all over, because there is no risk-free approach to working in a dirty field, but you do have to know how to practice higher standard so that you are not swept away and becoming a victim of the very ones you say you're going to serve. And it happens every year. So I want to share with you some strategy that's made a big difference in my life, if you think that might be applicable. And if not, I'm going to talk about it anyway. But what we could do, though, is take a break, and I'd like to know, have you found this useful so far as an intro to our day? Do you have questions about anything we've looked at right now in this segment? We are going to have Q&A time later, but do you have a question now? While it's fresh and maybe I wasn't clear on something or you'd like a little more elaboration? Because when we take a break, I'm here to serve you. But when we take a break, I'm taking the break too. So that means I don't get cornered for a private counseling session, or it doesn't mean that you then ask the question that you refused to ask in the class. Doesn't mean I don't care about you. Means I need a break too. They don't call me the bladder buster for nothing. And I do want to say, because I am here to serve you, if you do have a personal question, and of course that might be the case, and you feel it's a little bit too personal to ask from the floor, fair enough, write it down on a piece of paper. Submit it to me, and I'll be very happy to address it so that you can remain anonymous. I do care to respond to your questions. There you go. You have a question.
My question is that you mentioned there is a difference between teenage boys playing around.
Right.
Then a pedophile.
Yes.
Okay, could you please elaborate a little bit on that?
Yes. In other words, when sexual abuse can cover statutory boundaries. We would agree that if you have sex with a minor, even though they may have a more adult understanding, or they may be somewhat defiled, or they may already be sexually knowledgeable, they may have even initiated without fully understanding consequence at, say, 15. That's different than 5. And so, while it is in the law still a minor and thus a crime, and thus the person having sex with that 15-year-old is offending still, the impact of that is not the same upon a person's identity development as would be the case for a 4 or 5-year-old. Mm-hmm. Ah, thank you. Teenage boy having sexual relations with a child, again, which age at teenage? Are we talking 13, 14, 15, 17, 18, 19? In fact, and a friend of mine in North America who specializes in dealing with sexual abuse situations and herself is an incest survivor. She's a clinical therapist in Los Angeles dealing with these issues. She says that according to her research, the number one group sexually violating kids right now are teenage babysitting boys, average age 17. The second biggest group sexually violating children right now, teenage babysitting girls, average age 17. So our assumptions that the pedophile is some dirty old man somewhere, it may not be always factual. And so we need to know who's minding the children and what our teenagers are having access to, where appetites may be stimulated and where they turn around, not because they are pedophiles, but because they are provocated. And they have learned information that their orientation may not be toward children, but they are simply looking for a recreational sexual outlet, and that's what's available. There is a difference in motivation that needs to be understood. I'm not saying that there can't be a teenager who isn't fixated on children, make no mistake. I am saying, though, that's what needs to be clarified. Are we talking about a genuine pedophile? Because a pedophile, I don't think, is limited to just technical having sex. Because there's one thing about orientation and fixation versus experimentation without thought of consequence. Being boundaryless and provocated is different than being fixated on children as an object of sexual gratification. Does that bring clarity? Am I making sense? In other words, for someone to have a fixation on children as the object of their sexual interest, that is different than someone just using a child recreationally because that's all that's available and they're messing around. It's abusive, yes. It is damaging, yes. It's not the same, absolutely, as a pedophile orientation. So it's technically sexually offending, yes, but the motivation may not have been, I'm only oriented toward children. But now, again, the pedophile orientation can show up early and show up in the emerging teenager. Yes, so here's where we just want to get that clarified. And I appreciate you raising that very important little point there, okay? That's why it's kind of sad some kid, you know, some young adult has gotten involved in a sexual experience, like, you know, the 17-year-old gets involved with the 12-year-old or 15-year-old, and they are lumped in the same category as a pedophile, and that's not entirely accurate. There's where we need that clarification. Okay, so I appreciate you raising that. Was there another question?
Mm-hmm. Good point you mentioned about your counseling person. They're still told.
Okay, yes, I do speak quickly. Obviously, I've had a little caffeine this morning. And of course, for those of you who think you're holier for not drinking coffee, my view is drink it, don't drink it, you still die. But you know coffee's the spiritual drink. It had to have been God to tell Adam and Eve what to do with those ugly little beans that no one would have ever figured out on their own. Getting back to those 3 points, though, sir, to answer your question, when is it right to betray confidence? Number one, when you are pretty convinced that someone is going to hurt themselves, as in... Oh, that's not what you're wanting? No, that's it. In other words, when people come to me in the contract and they read through the contract, here's what I'm spelling out for them. I want them to understand that if they tell me, they're going to hurt themselves. If they tell me, they're going to hurt someone else. And if they tell me that they are sexually involved with minors, I will report it. And they know this from the get-go. I've had them sitting in my office, entire families. I've had to pick up the phone and call the police. What I always do first is I call my board. I call one of my board members and I say, here's the situation. Do you want me to go ahead and act as the director of this organization and take action? And then they say, yes, we do. And then I then pick up the phone and I call the investigative service or the police. And you know what? To their credit, they don't just jump in there and arrest this person and off they go to jail. They begin an investigatory process because they've understood that just through acrimonious divorces, accusations can be slung around that are not true. So just because a person has been named as an abuser does not mean they are automatically assumed to be guilty. They investigate to their So that's useful to also understand. Okay? Anybody else before we... Mm-hmm. Yes. Right, I heard of it. Mm-hmm. Well, you know, we can't undo what's been done, and I'm not saying it was wrong. Don't misunderstand me. How we treat people is different than a statement that we might make in culture. Policy is different than people, too. And there's where, as a pastoral worker in a public ministry, I am not a politician. It doesn't mean I don't vote. It doesn't mean I don't share my opinion and I don't influence those who do shape policy. My point is, my public platform is as a pastor, not a politician. If you're going to be a politician, you probably won't be very pastoral, because there are different organs in the body. We have kidneys and liver. Both filter toxins. They're not homogenized into one unit. And both are required to deal with poisons. And so my point is, for those who feel called to make a political statement, that doesn't make it invalid. Even if it means drawing a line in the sand that some find offensive. God draws a line in the sand with us, does he not? And so don't want you to think that in being redemptive, that doesn't mean we do nothing. It's how we respond to people is what I'm talking about. And even, for example, instead of saying politically, God get them, stop them, how about God save them? Because that would do two things, enlarge God's kingdom and stop that train. So I think a lot of times what Christians do, though, is we feel so powerless with what's going on in culture that often we use the arm of flesh by setting policy as the way to control the tide of darkness, and the real battle is fought in prayer through warfare, not just in shaping policy. So it's not that policy isn't important or speaking that we want to see marriage affirmed. That's not being unredemptive, I feel, because sometimes culture doesn't know it's going down the wrong path, and we are its voice of conscience, said Martin Luther King. So it doesn't always mean culture listens to the voice. Now, since we've already had the march, and let's say that there's a lot of bad attitude on that side of the camp, now what can we do to go make it right? There are also things we can do to mend fences and take it to another level that is redemptive. And I've met with gay leaders, and I had a gay activist in Los Angeles on a radio show live say to me one time, I don't always agree with your view, Cy, and I think it is okay to be gay, but you know what? You have done more to change people's attitudes toward understanding and compassion than all the gay marches have ever accomplished. You know, I didn't say it was okay to be gay. It's the attitude and the interaction with people. I met with gay leaders in a country, in the nation's capital, and one of them at the table over lunch, I met them with my pastor, that one gay activist began to cry. And he is a policy shaper in that country. And he said, this is the first time evangelicals have ever cared to meet with us and hear us. And he said, I know, Cy, that you'll never affirm homosexuality, but you know what? Would you stand against gay bashing? And I said, of course I would. I got a song about it on an album, and I stand against it in my messages. Of course I would. I think Jesus would. And see, there's where they stopped demonizing me. I never said it was okay to be gay. We didn't change our views. But when you get to build relationships with people, the demonization stops, and God has an opportunity through that bridge to affect people in ways even better than a march might. So what can we do to take it to the next level? That's a question. Intercessory prayer and building relationships. Okay? I don't think there's anything wrong that our culture knows that people have issue with where we're going in society and that we have concern and have stood to say so. And though the others may react against that, no matter how loving and gracious we are, they may never, ever do anything other than react against it, and we have to be big enough to take it. But what we do next may become very important. So I appreciate you raising what's a very real issue in the mix right now here. And I hope that answers it a little bit. You're welcome. And you know, the cool thing, what if we make a mistake? So we learn and we go do better. If you're not perfect, then at least be humble. True, everybody's been married for more than 10 minutes knows that fact. You know, I'm sorry. Practice, I'm sorry. And so that's true not just in marriage, it's true in our connection with culture. Yeah, you know what? Christian culture doesn't always get it right, but you know, at the end of the day, we really do care about people, and we want to reflect that. The only reason we're even standing on this issue is because we're afraid society's going down the wrong path, and we're playing emperor's new clothes, and we're thinking this is enlightenment, when actually, historically, it proves to be decadence. And you know, the word decadence and decay come from the same root word in the original language, the fruit that rots. And what do you know about rotting fruit? It never stops rotting. So the fact that we feel the tilt on the Titanic and that we want to put the brakes on a train going forward is not a bad thing. We just have to be careful how we do it. Okay? So it's difficult, but it's worth wading through difficulty to come out with a better solution. Appreciate you bringing that up. Now, you all need a break. And shall we listen to Miss Linda, who will give us the housekeeping details? There you go.